Hello, everybody. Good evening or good morning, wherever you are. Welcome to this Tikkun lecture of today. We have it on the philosophical foundation of digital humanism, and it will be done by Julia Nieder-Rümelin. And the moderation is by Edward Lee. Before starting the lecture and introducing also Edward, who will then introduce Julian, just some words to our initiative. We started 1.5 years ago with a workshop here at TU Wien, and there we stated or recognized the fundamental role of informatics, but we also pointed at several critical issues, which you know very well, the monopolistic structure in the web, issue of sovereignty, fake news, echo chamber, democracy, or AI, decision-making, role of humans, privacy issue. And we also agreed there at this workshop on our manifesto on digital humanism. And this manifesto had a very positive response. Nearly nobody was negative, but there was one recurring question which permanently came up. What do you want to do really? So, and you can't change anything. So a really pessimistic attitude. But look now what happened just in the last day. We have in the US, we have the antitrust lawsuit against Facebook, which is a really big thing. We have today the European Commission announced two acts, one on the Digital Service Act and one on the Digital Market Act. So responding to this issue of big companies in the web. Last week, the European Minister on Digitalization and Innovation signed the Berlin Declaration on a Digital Society and Value-Based Digital Government, where they highlight also the important point we have on a promotion of fundamental rights and democratic value also in the digital world, which is really coherent with our initiative. And on a different level, here in Vienna, the Vienna government announced the foundation of an institute on digital humanism with some funding. So there are several things happening. Not that these measures or activities will answer all our issues or will answer the open challenges, but that these are our, let's say, achievements. I think we can say that we contributed a little bit, but more importantly, the lesson is that things can change and that you can interfere and you can change, let's say, a little bit the world, and you just don't have to observe. So this is the positive message at the end of this terrible year, 2020. And I think we can look positively into the future. And this is not only because I'm always a very optimistic guy. So these were some words on our initiative, and further activities will be announced at the beginning of next year. We have some plans. On the organizational level, we have now the talk of Julian, 30 minutes, and then a 30 minutes discussion, which is moderated by Edward Lee. And at the end, we have again a piece of music selected by Peter Knees. And today it will be a little bit different, but we are looking forward to this. For the discussion or also for the presentation of Julian, for the discussion afterward, please mute your phone. And in case of question, comment, please tell us your name, who you are, and maybe from where you come. I have the honor to introduce Edward, who, as he writes in his short CV he has written, he has been working in the software systems for 40 years, and now he has turned to philosophical and societal questions related to technology. Edward was educated at Yale, MIT, and the Bell Labs, and then he is turned as professor to Berkeley, where he is now professor emeritus. And we can say that he's really one of the world leading experts in the field of cyber physical systems. And there he is the author of many outstanding papers as well as a textbook in this field. And in the last years, he published two books more related to the philosophical level or the societal implications of technology. One is called Plato and the Nerd. And the second one is co-evolution, the entwined future, and humans and machines. So really looking at the interplay of humans and machines. Edward is with us since the early beginning. He was also at the workshop. He is even a founder of this initiative, one can say. And he was providing and still is providing guidance with intellectual spirit and also support. And for this, I would really like to thank you, Edward, for being with us. And now I hand over to you for introducing Julia. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Hannes. I'd like to thank you for your leadership on this initiative. I think it's a really wonderful initiative. So it's a real pleasure to introduce Julien Niederhulen, who is professor of philosophy and political theory at the Ludwig Maximilians University in Munich. Don't be fooled by his background. He's not actually in San Francisco, I think, but I believe in Munich at the moment. So Julien has an extensive background in philosophy, physics, mathematics, and political science, which makes him a genuine polymath and a perfect person to speak in this seminar series. He's taught philosophy and ethics and political theory starting decades ago in Minnesota and then moving to the University of Tübingen and then University of Göttingen and then Humboldt University in Berlin and finally to Munich. So Julien has served as president of the German Association for Analytical Philosophy in the 1990s and more recently as president of the German Society for Philosophy. He's a member of the Berlin Academy of Sciences and Humanities and the European Academy of Sciences and Arts. And for 5 years, he took a break from academia and moved into cultural politics, serving as the state minister for culture and media in the first national government of Chancellor Gerhard Schroeder. So he's going to speak to us about the philosophical foundations of digital humanism, and then we're going to open it up for discussion. So, Julien, I'm very much looking forward to your comments. I'll turn over the floor to you.
Thank you very much for this introduction. There is a Zen wisdom that tells, if you are in a hurry, move slowly, and that's what we are going to do. So I will present the programmatic elements of what I call digital humanism. And maybe I should add some remarks about this initiative in Vienna and how this is correlated with to that, what we are doing in Germany and at other places. In fact, we met, Hannes Werthner and me, we met the beginning of 1919 when the book Digitaler Humanismus, eine Ethik für das Zeitalter der künstlichen Intelligenz, got a prize, got the prize for the political book in 1918 by the Bruno Kreisky Foundation. And it's not possible to have such beautiful ceremonies outside Vienna. So it was really beautiful. And we had a very interesting panel discussion and Hannes Werthner participated in it, and this was our first exchange, and then we found out that we have quite similar goals and conceptions, and we should in some way or the other cooperate. We are since then thinking about establishing, for example, a grad school or grad college for those students and postdocs who are interested in that topic. Unfortunately, the book itself is only in German and Italian. Well, I speak also Italian quite well, and not in English. So for the moment, those who are from abroad, not from Germany or from Italy, and who cannot read German, can't read the details of my argument. That's a pity, but I hope this can be changed soon. So I think I should present the conception of digital humanism in three parts. The first part is quite foundational. It is about the question, what is humanism? So digital humanism is a form of humanism. At least I think it is. One could also define digital humanism such that it is not a form of humanism. And so the question arises, what is humanism? If you look to the history of thought and the cultural history, then you have quite different accounts of what humanism is. There is the term humanism, for example, in the Italian Renaissance humanism of the 15th, 16th, partly also earlier, the thought and philosophy that developed there 120 years earlier than in the rest of Europe. Then, for example, you call humanism also the development in philosophy and the humanities in Germany in the 19th century, Wilhelm von Humboldt, Alexander von Humboldt, Herder, Hamann, and so on. So somehow establishing a certain idea of Bildung, that is difficult to translate in English, formation, sophistication, erudition, education, whatever, of Bildung, that became for some 70 years maybe the leading conception worldwide. It is now in a situation of decay. We come to that later. And then what is about Stoicism in Europe, or about Confucianism in China, or about Platonism and Aristotelism in ancient Greek times? Well, I think all these are variants. Even Karl der Große, midst of the medieval ages, his Karolingische Reformen, the reforms that he initiated in the Bildungs sector, is a version of humanism. And the interesting question is there something in common? And I think it is. It is the central idea of human authorship. What constitutes human authorship? This is the basic philosophical question. And then what are the conditions of agency, human agency? For example, the so-called Kantian socialists in the 19th century argued like that. Kant developed an idea of ethics based on the idea of human dignity, and this again on the basis of some form of practical reason in orienting practice on the categorical imperative. But Kant left out what the political implications are. And the ethical socialists in the 19th century said, Fabian Society in England, similarly, said, well, then we have a moral duty that the state offers for all equal chances of Bildung. And the state offers for all something that might be called in the meantime, social, individual, equal rights. Otherwise, the preconditions of human agency and dignity are not fulfilled. Again, a step further, I would say that rationality, freedom, responsibility, these three quite central normative notions of human existence and human forms of life, are representatives, all three, of the more fundamental one, agency, authorship, or to be more precise, being affected by reasons. If reasons of any kind don't play any role, there is no agency, there is no human authorship. Now, difficult question arises, what are reasons? Reasons are somehow normative, so they cannot be described by the means of the natural sciences. How does that fit in a worldview that is based on natural sciences and other sciences? So many questions arise. I've tried to answer some of these questions in my last study, Eine Theorie praktischer Vernunft, the theory of practical reason, that was published this year in July. that will very probably soon publish also in English. Now to the second part. The second part of my talk is about what is humanism in times of the digital change? What does change with digitization? And the answer is, maybe disappointingly, not so much as you might think. And there's one of the big fights that we have in this discussion. It's about the status of so-called artificial intelligence. My view is, and that is constitutive for this form of digital humanism, that artificial intelligence or artificial intelligences or robots based on complex software systems, even those software systems that from themselves learn and develop new forms of behavior and so on and so forth, are not agents, have no authorship. There is no person there. To put it polemically, we should not fall back to one version or the other of animism. Animism formed human thought for the most time of human existence on this earth. And it was difficult enough to get out of this animistic worldview. Even now, many think that, for example, plants have wishes, or that plants develop in a certain way because they have preferences, for example, to have more light, and so on and so forth. And now one can easily understand that if we develop software-driven algorithmic systems that behave as if they acted, as if they gave an advice, as if they were empathetic, and so on and so forth, that we then interpret these systems as they actually have empathetic emotions, they actually can value or evaluate things, and so on and so forth. So as long as we use this language metaphorically, that everything is okay. If we do not use this language metaphorically, and that is unfortunately quite widespread in the meantime, then we are caught in a trap, the trap of animism. And this would change everything. So I give one example. If software systems indeed have mental states, then the question arises whether at least animal rights are applicable to them. And if they act because of the cluster of normative concepts that are closely interlinked, I mentioned freedom, responsibility, and rationality, and maybe dignity, but let this out, then we ascribe personhood to those systems. And if we ascribe personhood, then we are not allowed to treat them, these software systems, as mere means, if we use the Kantian term. So to make it short, the short version of what I'm arguing for is there is no strong AI. Now, unfortunately, the terms strong and weak AI are used quite differently and not very precisely. But if we call strong AI a thesis, not a system, a thesis, and the thesis is that those systems that behave as if have the corresponding mental properties, then one of the basic assumptions of digital humanism is that there does not exist any strong AI. Now, what's with weak AI? Weak AI usually is understood as the thesis I take it like this as a thesis, that it is possible to simulate every kind of human behavior based on software systems. This thesis seems to me also to be wrong. Maybe we have time afterwards to discuss why this is wrong. But the main argument is the first one. There is no strong AI. The second question can be left open, because even if we answer the first question, is there strong AI negatively, we get rid of the most fundamental ethical problems combined with digitalization. Now, let's draw some implications from that. So if we do not have the disruptive problem of inventing or constructing another type of persons or another type of animated beings, then there are still many ethical challenges. And if you take humanism as the main thesis that we want to live in a world that is as humane as possible, that gives every individual as much dignity as possible, as much liberty, as much authorship, equal authorship as possible, then the question is, what is changing by the digital transformation? And I pick out three fields of application, so to say. The first is, again, Bildung. Bildung in German, formation, education, erudition, sophistication, whatever. Bildung. This central concept of almost every kind of humanism, beginning with Plato in Europe, or with Confucius in China, or maybe also with Buddha in South Asia. This central concept strives at allowing persons to be themselves, so to say, not to be a mere means for other aims, but to act on the basis of a certain self-constructed or self-developed identity. The term Persönlichkeitsbildung is a good example. Persönlichkeitsbildung is not the mere effect of influencing of certain sensory stimuli that have a causal effect on the person. The idea is to give the person, the kid or the young adult, the possibility to choose for herself, to choose for herself who she wants or he wants to be. So if you take this emphatic idea of Bildung, the question is, what is changing with digital transformation? I think to the positive. There are many changes to the positive. Why? Because at least as the school systems in almost all countries in the world tried to develop cognitive competences, knowledge, and so on, in order to allow these persons to be a useful part in economy and in society. The humanistic Bildung always argued against it and said the main aim of humanist Bildung is to be free, to be yourself, to have dignity, to live your own life. And certainly to live your own life is only possible if you're not dependent or too much dependent economically. So there is an interrelation between these two fields. What's changing is that mere data knowledge is almost useless in the meantime. You need some knowledge that one might call knowledge for orientation. So for embedding certain data in broader relations, this is true. Their knowledge is important for that, but the mere knowledge of data is obsolete. So you get a lot of time. You have now much more time for judgment, for discussion, for discourse, for finding out what is good for me and what is good for others, for practicing cooperation, and so on and so forth. So it's not so much the competence to use digital tools. This is important, but this is not central for this digital humanist conception of Bildung. The most central notion is to develop these or those capacities that allow us to be ourselves, live our life, have a fully developed agency in life, being not too much dependent on the contingent events in life, to stand to yourself, so to say, even in times of crises. And so I think one of the main challenges of digital humanism is to transform the educational systems into a system which has at the center judgment and the strength to decide and to cooperate, to find out together what's good for me and what's good for us. It's not so much about mere empirical knowledge. Second field, democracy. There's something strange going on. Maybe one might say that the idea of the Republic, French Republic, 1789, which was much more influential in continental Europe than the British development or the American development, is based on the idea that we as citizens decide what's going on. And since we are so many, this is not possible, and we have some representation necessary. And in France, we vote for one president. Earlier, he was 7 years in office, 7 years, and then a second term, so 14 years in all. And this president represents somehow the people in the sense of Greek demos, not ethnos. Now we have the digital tools, for example, liquid democracy. So it would be possible, it would be technically possible to turn or to realize that Rousseauian ideal of direct democracy. Another question is, should we or not? And this again is a quite complicated question. My answer is no, we shouldn't. But not because we don't trust the demos, the individual citizen, but because we know, for example, from some theorems of collective choice, that direct democratic decision procedure would, with logical necessity, lead to a chaotic situation. This is one of the reasons why we should not use digital tools in order to end representative judicial democracy with the divide of powers and so on and so forth. Parliaments, executives, courts. There's another reason. The reason is that if you allow the majority to decide in every aspect, then individual authorship is in danger, is threatened. So you need a judicial state in order to restrain majority power. Well, there are some other arguments in favor of a judicial based on individual liberties and rights, including social equal rights. Without social state, there's no democracy, I'm convinced. But we could use digital tools in order to strengthen the democratic processes. In that sense, and I myself was, as you know, a member of a government, and I know that we always had problems to include expertises that are not in the ministry and neither in science, but are in those parts of the society where they have direct experience of what's going on. This would be possible. So the process of opinion formation could be strengthened and enlarged by digital tools. And now the third and last field, what I want to mention, and this is economy and the social life. Usually a widespread assumption is technical progress is strong. We have in general a strong economic progress, a strong social progress, and maybe a strong humane process. This is not true. If you look to the history, we have ups and downs. If you take, for example, the productivity rate and the development of productivity rate, you find out, astonishingly enough, Robert Gordon, an American economist, has written a big book about this question, that certain innovations, technical innovations, indeed did foster productivity, but others not. For example, the first wave of digitization after the Second World War did not help. The second did help in the 90s with personal computers and the World Wide Web. The third wave, in which we are presently, till now, did not help. That's strange. And many colleagues from the economic department don't really like to discuss it, but I think we should discuss it from a political perspective. For me, it's obvious that we have to use digital tools in order for humane goals. And one of the humane goals is to produce economic values with lesser efforts in terms of resources and labor power. This is necessary, especially for the global South. If they go a similar way of industrialization in Africa as China did, as a copy from the European and the American way, then the ecological catastrophe is secure, is absolutely secure, with 2.5 billion persons living in Africa in the midst of this century. So digitization has to be used, focused on to make human life better and to have economic processes that help to fulfill basic human needs. We are far away from that. This is also a very broad debate. And if you're interested, we can discuss that in further detail afterwards. But to conclude, I think the European approach, human-centered, they speak of human-centered digitization. That's very good. It's a good term, it's digital humanism, so to say. Till now has almost no concrete implications, policy implications. So this has to be changed in the next years. And I hope that we can help this impressing initiative in Vienna and maybe in other states and in other cities in Europe. Thank you very much. Look forward for the discussion.
Thank you, Julian. I would like to suggest that questions can come either in the form of a question in the chat, or you could raise your hand using the Zoom mechanism, and then I will unmute you. Maybe I'd like to kick it off with a question myself. You caution us against falling back on animism when looking at AIs, I think quite rightly. But the question that I have is, what is it about biology that enables agency that is missing in silicon?
Yeah, that's one of the deepest questions. Well, I would say there is no categorical argument that tells that software systems cannot have mental states. So this is not my argument. My argument is different. It is like that. We design software systems such that they simulate behavior, partly human behavior. And then we shouldn't be so stupid, then interpret these systems as having the mental states humans have if they behave like that. So it's somehow cheating ourselves. Yeah. Then there are, as you know very well, but probably not all of the audience, because not everybody comes from the philosophy, there are good arguments. The Californian philosopher John Searle developed two arguments. One is quite well known, the Chinese chamber argument. The other is not so well known. It's about realism. I think the second argument is much more convincing. So the second argument, maybe I bring it shortly, is like this. What is he? Well, it's decades ago when he wrote this, therefore the terminology is a little bit different from today's terminology. What is a computer? Well, a computer is a system where there is a electrical current, stronger and weaker current of electricity. And there are complex, how do you call it? You have to help me, Edward Lee. There are complex, how do you call it? Okay. And there are two basic interpretations of this. And one is propositional logic, and the other is arithmetics. And Boolean algebra tells they are homomorph, they have the same structure. Whatever we use, we have different interpretations. And in principle, one can think of many, indefinitely many other interpretations, maybe most of it totally useless. Yeah. So it's us who interpret a system that has physical and technical properties as a syntactic and then semantic. This also syntax, yeah? So also it is not a syntactic machine, because the syntax is something we add as an interpretation of certain constellations of electrostatic and electrodynamic systems. There's some discussion about it. I know very well. Maybe we could continue that discussion, but I wanted to introduce also the second argument, because the second argument is not very well known. And this depends on realism. So every entity in the world is in one state. We know certain aspects of this state. We almost never know every aspect of the state, but the entity itself has only one state. Yeah? This is a precondition of this argument.
Okay. We have a few questions raised in the chat. Let me see. Johan Nasevet says he has a question about weak AI. Can you?
I have unmuted myself, if that's okay. Okay.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Julian, for this very nice presentation. I want to invite everybody who is interested in the current state of the debate about moral standings of robots, in particular, to look at the most recent publications in the series of robophilosophy conferences. I think here, Julian, you have presented a one position in the debate. Maybe I think relative to the empirical results we have from human-robot interaction studies, matters are not as simple. We cannot, as philosophers, simply present an ontological thesis what these systems are or are not. And on the basis of that ontological judgment, make a normative recommendation. So I think this is an issue that the moral standing of robots is a very complex and complicated issue, but it must also take into account empirical results. That's simply a comment I wanted to make. But my question was about weak AI. I was puzzled by the fact that you would believe that there is an a priori argument that philosophers have that to the effect that we cannot simulate every behavior of human beings.
Yeah. Okay. So two questions, two answers, quite short again. Well, you might think, and I understand that you think that, that I have no relation to the empirical world in that field. That is not true. I'm director at the Bavarian Institute for Digital Change, Digital Transformation. And I was involved in two European research projects that were mostly by engineers, also lawyers, but engineers. One is RoboLaw, so you find it also, RoboLaw, and the other is Credits for Health. And so we discussed many of these empirical questions. And now one has to discriminate between two questions. The one question is, how do persons react to robots? Let's say humanoid robots, for example, in medical care. And this is a very complex point of discussion. For example, one can see that some of the elderly people also are happy with robots that help without coming too close, so to say, because if humans get too close to you and you still have an attitude of, well, don't touch me and respect my dignity and so on and so forth, and you know that robots are not humans, then it might make this situation easier. And there are empirical findings, lots of empirical findings, especially in Japan, because there the development is more they are far, far ahead of Europe, for example, in that respect. So there are many quite complex empirical questions. But the other question, whether we should interpret robots if they are similar to humans as being persons, is quite different. I say there's no categorical argument that this is not possible. But as things stand, it is a version of animism, projection, irrationality. Yeah. And if we tend to adopt this irrationality, in fact, we had to stop, at least a moratorium would be necessary. We cannot allow a situation in which we totally instrumentalize persons. This is unacceptable. That would destroy the humane basis, juridical humane basis, of almost all democracies in the world. And the second question, well, this is about Gödel. So if you teach logics, then you find it quite interesting that a majority, at least, maybe 90% even, of your students is able to deliver a sound proof of the theorems of first order predicate logic. It needs only some weeks of lecture and some exercises, and then they are able to do it. And how do they do it? Well, there is no algorithm. We know that since 1930. We know that there is no algorithm that produces this proof, these proofs. Now we get a little into analytic philosophy, but you had this question. So I add that for me, logical systems, logical languages, are nothing else than a representation or a systematization of parts of human thought. So this is a little bit too rude, because they also not only systematize, but also influence our form of drawing conclusions, at least in science and philosophy. But in principle, it's nothing else. So for example, deontic logic. Till now, there is no adequate system of deontic logic. Why? Because the way we argue, for example, in juridical or ethical context, is not represented totally not adequately represented by any existing deontic logic system. So we take this as a starting point, or as a, how to affirm a theory, So the affirmation in this case is how we think a certain argument is valid or not valid. And if this is not represented in the deontic system, then the deontic system is not complete or is inadequate. Now, our reasoning, our form of deliberating reasons is extremely complex, and is certainly much more complex than first order predicate logic. Yeah, it includes modal logic, deontic logic, higher order predicate logic, and so on and so forth. So except from propositional logic, in all these realms, there is no algorithm that represents reasoning. That's the argument. So you can doubt whether whether these findings of the 1930s, Gödel especially, Church and others, are right, but almost nobody doubts that. Or you can doubt that reasoning is so closely interlinked with logic analysis and logic systems. So these are the two points where one can argue against it. But if you accept these two elements, so that Gödel is right, and that our reasoning is what decides on the adequacy of logics, and therefore is much more complex than propositional logic, then there is no way out to draw the conclusion that weak AI, in the sense of the thesis, is possible on the basis of algorithmic systems. On the basis of algorithmic systems. So that might change one day.
Okay, we have another question in the chat from Alex Schmoltz about the foundation and posthumanism. Can you unmute yourself?
Yeah, thank you. Also from my end for these nice talks. I'm the executive director of the Austrian Institute for Research on FET, and I will act as a researcher and resident for the Federal Ministry of Digitization upon next year. And I really like your implications on your talk, and I have a questions on the fundamentations. You said that there are different humanisms, and there is one humanism, or one has the same thing. And you said that your answer, your programmatic answer, is human condition, is human authorship. But what's the difference to computational authorship? This is one question. And the other question is that in humanism, there has been different philosophical scholars that has answered the question to the human condition differently. So how is your answer different to other philosophers that has provided another program for the human condition?
Well, I begin with the second question. In fact, I think that this account of humanism, as I developed it a little in this beginning of my talk, covers most of what we call humanism. So all these different humanism, they are quite different. Some, for example, stress ancient languages. Yeah, it's quite important for humanistic Bildungs conception. Yeah, Greek and Latin, that's of no relevance for this kind of humanism, I argue for. But the basic idea of human authorship and accompanied by dignity, equal liberty, or liberty and equality, seems to me to be in all kinds of humanisms. Well, there are differences, and one might say, even like in physics, you need many centuries to detect certain laws. And for example, the Stoics accepted that slavery is wrong because human dignity does not depend on the status in the society. So this is a very strong humanistic insight, but they practice slavery. And the same is even for a longer time with women. Yeah? So many humanists were not convinced that women have the same status as men. Plato had this idea. Yeah? Plato already, yeah? It's a long time ago, interestingly enough, but then it was forgotten again. So there are many different forms of humanisms, especially if you look outside Europe. So China, for example, Confucianism, yeah, is also a form of humanism. The opposition is legalism for many centuries. Yeah? So you have to manipulate persons by telling them how you keep them in awe and how certain behavior is sanctioned and other behavior is incentivized and so on. Yeah. So this is the opposition to that. So I think indeed authorship and the accompanying normative concepts, liberty, equality, but also responsibility are so central that you find it in almost every version of humanism again. Yeah. So this is the first question. And the second, well, I can be very short in that. If authorship is such a, such a thick and important and central concept that is not possible, you cannot have this concept without liberty, responsibility, rationality, and many others. Yeah, there is a famous and beautiful article by Peter Strawson, Freedom and Resentment, where he argued, well, forgiveness or gratitude or resentment is not possible if you do not think that the person, you are grateful, or that you resent and so on and so forth, is not free in what she does. So without a certain form of freedom, it's totally irrational to resent or to be grateful or whatever. And then he concludes his beautiful article with the remark, well, I leave the question open whether we live in a deterministic universe or not. So he's a compatibilist. But I tell the one realm of thought, so natural science, cannot intervene in the other realm of thought, where responsibility, freedom, gratitude, forgiveness, and so on play a certain role, because this would mean that we give up the human form of life. Yeah? We would drop out of the human form of life. And in that sense, the short answer to your first question is, there is no machine that acts, yeah, because all this is not in place there.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, we have quite a few questions in the chat. I think this one will be a nice, easy one for you, Julian, and a good way to kind of reemphasize, I think, one of your key points. So the question is, what's your this comes from Florian Michaelis. What's your stance on chatbots or virtual agents or embodied user interfaces, which are exactly building on turning systems into characters?
Yeah, this is indeed a good application of these arguments. So I would say nothing against chatbots. You make a phone call to some restaurant or whatever, you get an answer, you ask certain questions, you get an answer, everything fine. But I give the advice to the legislator that everybody has always to know, is it a chatbot or is it a person? And if this is indiscriminable, if you don't know it from the tone of the mode of speaking and so on and so forth, then you have to be informed from the start. Otherwise, we get into this animistic development that in the end destroys also trust. Then if we don't know, is it the chatbot or is it a person? A more challenging example is juridical decisions. Good part of juridical decisions can be algorithmicized. Well, for the moment, not so big parts of it, but it will develop. So the question is, can we allow that software systems take court decisions, for example? And I would say, no, we cannot, because they are not responsible.
Yeah. So this is a question from Alec Balasescu. He says, I think perhaps the difference from animism is the fact that the entity endowed with agency changed from a natural phenomenon or object to a human-made one. He cites Alec, So would you consider perhaps an artificial intelligence a misnomer that created political effects?
Well, not to be misunderstood, I think we all think in the meantime that at least mammals have mental states, and many animals have mental states. I took the example of a plant. Most of us think plants have not mental states, although they sometimes behave that could be interpreted as having preferences or intentions or whatever, how they develop, how they grow, and so. So the analogy would be about plants and artificial systems. And in fact, plants are there. We intervene a lot with modern genetic methods in the meantime. But nevertheless, plants are something that we didn't construct at the beginning, at least. And that's different. So computers, robots, software systems are our constructions, and we organize them such that they have certain behavioral traits. And in some cases, we want them to have behavioral traits that we know from humans. Yeah? One can also discuss the question why we are so keen about this. Yeah? Why? Yeah. One could also take the Leibnizian view, the famous mathematician and philosopher, rationalist philosopher, Georg Wilhelm Leibniz, who developed the first working arithmetic machine, quite interesting. And he had the perspective and said, well, we use it in order to get rid of boring things, yeah? Not coping human capacities, yeah? But to get rid of things that we don't like and that are time consuming. So it's more the idea of complementary entities and not substitutive entities. And this is maybe another topic that we could discuss in this context of digital humanism. Shouldn't the direction of developing AI be different, more in complementary, less in analogy or simulation?
So I'm going to use my privilege as moderator here to inject a question. So your argument keeps emphasizing this observation that these technologies are created by us, and that fact that they're created by us is a essential feature that you leverage. In the book that I published earlier this year, I actually argue that that's less true than we realize. This view is that technology is the result of a top-down intelligent design.
Yeah.
And I make the argument that actually there's very strong evolutionary forces that are very much out of our control in how technology develops. Yeah. And that might undermine some of your arguments.
Yeah, that's a very interesting question at the end of our talk, probably, because we have to stop, I think. And we should go, maybe we have another possibility to go into that furthermore. The question is, what is changing with that? Self-learning software systems, for example. It is true that we, in the end, have to face probably the situation that we cannot tell how these machines really work. So we have certain output data and input data, but in the end, we can't tell what exactly is going on there. And this is a problem also for autonomous driving and for the legislation around that, also in Germany, which is not behind in that field, as one might think, but more or less ahead, I think. And in fact, one quite important question is, can we allow some software system to organize automatic driving if we don't know exactly how it works? And if you have only statistical data and say, well, in many cases, in almost every case, it's working well. Is this possible? I think it must be possible one day. But I think it does not change the status. Yeah, that does not change the status of the machines. So my point, if you remind our last short discussion, I'm not a religious person. I use this metaphor just to explain again, we are not God. Yeah. Because there is one famous book about the homo deus, yeah. So we invent or we construct or we let or we allow that machines construct themselves as persons. So something like that. And I think this is a quite threatening perspective, and we should think that through before we say, well, that's the development of technology, so let's face the facts. That's what we have to expect in the future. If this is the case, then indeed one had to be much more careful with the future development, as I hope that we must be.
Okay. I, with apologies to the other quite a few very interesting questions in the chat, I think we should move to the next stage. I think this was a very nice closing comment by Julian, and I'd like to give a virtual applause to Julian, and thank you very much for speaking with us today. So Peter, can you take over and give us our musical offering for the day?
All right, thanks for the handoff, Edward. And thank you, Julian, for the great presentation. Let me just get this right here. So I'm gonna end as we usually do. We're gonna end with a musical piece, and in the final notes. And today's final notes are by Queen with their track "Machines" or "Back to Humans." So the title already shows that this is a great fit, which is from the 1984 album "The Works." And thanks go to Stefanie Vogovic for making this perfect suggestion for a music track for today. And Stefanie is, besides her administration efforts for the DECOM initiative, also responsible for our Twitter channel. So let me take that as an opportunity to invite you to follow us on Twitter at DECOMTOV. Also to check our website for upcoming events, sign the manifesto if you haven't done so yet, or also check out all talks so far on our YouTube channel. And on that YouTube channel, as a little Christmas bonus, I would say you can also now find a playlist with the DECOM soundtrack containing all the tracks played at the end so far, including today's, plus a couple more. So if you don't know what to listen to, then that might be a possibility for you. The next event, just to announce that quickly, will be on January 19th.
Peter, you have to share the screen.
I will in a second. I won't forget, just to make sure that we can try it right away. Yes, I hope you can see it now already. So as you will also see at the end of the clip, the next event will be on January 19th, which will be a panel moderated by George Mitakidis on the topic, or the question rather, of digital colonialism. And I think with that, that's it for today, and that's it for this year. So from my side, I wish you happy holidays and see you next year. And as always, stay safe and goodbye. And I'm gonna start Queen now to transition you out of this talk. Bye-bye. Machines.
Thank you. It was a great presentation and a great discussion. Thanks.
Thank you, everybody. Okay. Thank you, Julian.
Thanks, Julian.
No, I liked it very much. Thank you.
Bye.
We Bye. Could have continued for another hour.
Yeah, sure.
Easily.
Okay. Have all relaxing days. Bye.
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 Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.